Hello and welcome to the first brand new Faith and Friends of 2017. We are back. We are kind of healthy and we are happy to spend the next 30 minutes with you. It's hard to believe we're already over halfway into the first month of the year. And whether it's been a good first few weeks or not a good first few weeks for you, you can rest in the assurance that God is going to be with you from now to the end of the year. Of course, the start of a new year is a time when many people choose to make resolutions. And did you guys make any resolutions?
I generally don't make any resolutions. I guess my philosophy is every day is a new day, so let's just do the best we can each individual day and not try and do anything overreaching. Because, too often when we make these New Year's resolutions and two or three days into the new year, you slip up and you forget about it, and then you just feel like you've already lost it, which is a common feeling. So I just try and take every day as a new day.
Yeah, I've tried to adopt an area of focus like we have with our basketball and football officials each year. They're asked to kind of focus in on a certain area of the game, and when it's faltering, like Mark said, we don't quit. We try and continue to focus on that. And failure is when you fail to get back up, not when you fall down. And so trying to keep getting back up in those areas of focus has been my focus.
Mm-hmm. Well, a Forbes.com study indicates that only 8% of people who make resolutions actually keep them all year long. Now, of course, as we've mentioned, it's never too late to start over. Yeah. If you do strive to do things differently this new year and then you find yourself failing, don't give up. As Andy said, get back up, start over. Commit your desires to God and ask Him to give you the ability to achieve these new goals.
Now, Forbes.com offers a few tips on how to set out to succeed at these resolutions. So get your pen and paper out. Here we go. Number one, make your goals specific. Number two, measure the progress. Allow yourself to celebrate over each mini success. Number three, be patient. Change does not happen instantly. Number four, share your goals with your friends and your family. Having accountability in your plan can be very helpful to keep you motivated. Number five, schedule it. Meaning if you're resolving to exercise more, then figure out a plan that forces that into your daily schedule. Don't assume something that was not a habit in 2016 will instantly become a habit in 2017. Number six, something is better than nothing. If you don't see yourself achieving 100% of your plan, focus on each step necessary to get you closer to that goal. And finally, number seven, get up when you slip up. Don't let minor setbacks cause you to give up.
And we want to add a number eight to that list of tips, which is commit your plans to God. As we mentioned earlier, ask God to show you what changes are needed in your life to achieve these goals. In fact, it's good to even consult with God before you make your resolutions. What does He want for your life? Now, coming up later in today's show, we'll talk more about the 2017 Faith Challenge, 12 spiritual workouts, each designed to help you become more focused on God and more focused on daily lifestyle choices that help us to get closer to God.
Well, let's jump to our scripture today that's designed to help you do that. Today's scripture comes to us from 1 Peter 1:13 through 15. Therefore, prepare your minds for action, keep a clear head, and set your hope completely on the grace to be given to you when Jesus the Messiah is revealed. As obedient children, do not be shaped by the desires that used to influence you when you were ignorant. Instead, be holy in every aspect of your life, just as the one who called you is holy. God recognizes that we are sinful people who make mistakes, and we live difficult lives where we're fighting within ourselves to be able to step forward the way we want to. But God is saying to us, don't let the past pull you back from being able to move forward. Instead, recognize that God wants to pull you out of that. It can take a while. It can be little by little, baby steps sometimes, but that is what's necessary to move on to the very next thing.
So important to be desiring that holiness and desiring that change. And when you fall, you do want to get back up and desire it again, becoming more like Jesus. That's the goal.
That's right. Well, perhaps this year, one of your New Year's resolutions is to have a better all-around character in your life. If so, then you're in agreement with a group of educators in Putnam County. That and nine other stories comprise the top 10 list most watched Faith and Friends interview stories. Here are the 10 most popular.
And coming in at number 10 is the Converge Prayer Rally that brought hundreds of teens and area adults into Lima's town square for an afternoon of prayer and praise. It was later reported that crime was unexpectedly low in Lima that very weekend, despite unseasonably warm temperatures, which often encourages higher crime activity. Number 9, local dancers participate in the Nutcracker. 60 area ballet dancers were chosen to dance with the Moscow Ballet Company in a one-time performance at the Lima Civic Center. The girls spent 7 weeks preparing for the once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. At number 8, Guy Penrod comes to the Nyswanger to be part of a crusade to focus on stroke awareness and, even more importantly, salvation awareness.
FCA Leadership Camp gets the number 7 spot. Looking forward to another group of local students experiencing that leadership camp again this year in Liberty Center. Linnea Diller, throwing for God, the state champion thrower, talks about who inspires her to be her best in her sport. The Ohio State thrower gets the 6th highest spot.
Number 5 belongs to Tim Tebow's Night to Shine special needs prom held at the First Assembly Church of God. Another event is planned for this year, February 10th. Guy Penrod makes a second appearance in our top 10. When we shared his thoughts on music, salvation, and reaching the lost, you all responded. That episode was the 4th most watched video of 2016.
And at number 3 was Jennifer's interview with local youth Lauren Cunningham, a cancer survivor and blood donor advocate. Number 2 on our most watched video list, the Midwest Volleyball Championships, the 2nd largest homeschool volleyball tournament in the country, takes place in Fort Wayne. This past fall, the Allen County Junior High team won their division. And finally, the most watched Faith and Friends video of 2016, well, it's today's In the Community segment, as Dancy Moeller talks with Ottawa Elementary Principal Dean Brinkman about the importance of teaching students character traits. Here again is the interview that talks about why it is so important to include character as part of a complete educational plan.
Well, you were doing some great things in Ottawa, and it's a town and a community that you know well. You grew up there.
Yes, ma'am.
And you want to see better things for your community, and you're maybe taking it from a different approach than you know, some school administrators might do. So let's talk about what the Titan Pride program is all about.
Well, the Titan Pride program is something that my staff and I came up with last year, and we really wanted to work on character education. I think the role of schools nowadays is obviously the academics and creating a safe environment, but also I want to try to instill the values and morals into students so that they can become productive members of our community and our society, and hopefully get that sense that we are part of a community and they can give back to their community through the values and morals that we are teaching at Ottawa every day.
You're seeing maybe some pieces missing in
sure.
students today?
You can say that, yeah.
Okay.
And I think that's really important. You know, some of the things that we talk about, we have 23 essentials at OE, that's what they're called, the Essential 23. And they talk about honesty, they talk about respect, they talk about conversation skills. So looking each other in the eyes when you're talking to them. When you greet an adult, call them Mr. or Mrs. Shake their hand when you meet them. Hold doors open for young ladies or other people. But also in a school setting, we're talking about some different values that they can develop as well, such as, you know, before answering, make sure you're raising your hand and you're called upon. If another student is struggling in class, encourage them instead of making fun of them. You know, don't expect rewards, don't make excuses. So these are things that I know go on at home. These are some of the values and morals that are instilled at home. But my sense is that there's no such thing as a value-free or a value-neutral school. We have to teach values in any school system. Mm-hmm. And teachers do it every single day. And if we don't teach values, if we don't teach morals, then what we're teaching the kids is that values aren't important. Mm-hmm. So we really wanted to reinforce some of the things that are going on at home. And for the kids that may not get enough of it, we're introducing it to them. And hopefully we're making a big difference in their life.
A couple of things struck me that you said, you know, when you were talking about addressing your other parents or teachers as Mr. and Mrs. Mm-hmm. That is something that I have noticed has changed since I was a student. Now parents actually say, oh, just call me Dancy and, you know,
sure.
drop the Mrs. But I think we've done our children a disservice in doing so.
And again, it may be a little hokey, you know, 1950s, 1960s type of culture of Mr. and Mrs. and yes, sir, and no, ma'am. But I think it's really important. What it does is it creates a culture of respect.
Right.
And it doesn't matter what culture or what socioeconomic classification you're from or what religion you're in. Every one of those demographics, they honor respect and trustworthiness and,
yeah,
and fairness. So those are the types of things that we're trying to create. I may be wrong, but I feel like when a student needs to call an adult Mr. or Mrs.
Yes.
I think that's really important.
Yeah.
So we're trying to start when they're young. And what's kind of neat about it, each of the students, K through eight, is put into one of five houses. And each of the houses compete every single month for rewards. So the five houses are some of the five tenets of what we try to promote at OE. It stands for pride. So purpose, our purpose is to learn. Respect, we must respect each other. Individuality, you know, respect each other's individuality and treat others like you want to be treated.
Mm-hmm.
Determined to do your best and set high expectations for yourself. So there's five houses. Each house has their own color. Each house is made up of a lot of different grade levels. So if you're looking at me in the eye right now, now as a teacher, I would give you a Titan ticket. So here you go, you're on Titan ticket.
All right.
And the students would go through and they would put their Titan tickets in their house. And every day we update the score, I guess, in the school. And then at the end of the month, we have a house assembly where we're split into our houses and we have little competitions and games, and we reinforce some of the essentials that we're going through each month. On the announcements, we reinforce the essentials every day. And to see the immediate impact is so rewarding.
Yeah.
When I walk down the hallway now, kids are looking me in the eyes. They're saying, you know, one of the things we say is when somebody asks you a question, you return, you say, you answer them, then you return with another question.
Mm-hmm.
So now I'm looking at kids and they're smiling in the hallways. They come up, they shake my hand. They say, hi, Mr. Brinkman, how are you doing today? And they respond back, fine, you know, how are you? So
yes,
this is those small things that make a big difference.
Well, you know, and in today's world, you know, I'm feeling like my grandparents did because, you know, we sit around and talk about, oh, the degradation of society and how, you know, nobody can have a conversation face to face anymore because you can just text someone and it's immediate. You don't even have to care about your spelling or, you know, grammatical, you know, punctuation, anything like that. So I think it is important. I love the thought that you have to have follow up with a question. Mm-hmm. That's how conversation goes, right?
Yep.
So yeah, that's huge. And are you planning and hoping to see a change then migrate into the classroom when it comes to their academic performance?
Well, yeah, of course.
Yeah.
I think they go hand in hand. And what we've seen already, you know, some of the things we talk about is responsibility and making sure you're turning in all your work and making sure that you do your very best on every test. And I think we have seen, and if it's not an academic necessarily, we are seeing some changes behaviorally. And I think it's just, it's going to happen. It's going to affect, if you're more disciplined and you're more courteous and you're more respectful and then you have a more respectful environment, academics are going to make a change for the better. And this does, I mean, this has an impact on all students. Doesn't matter if they're a straight A student or
you
know, a student that struggles. And the thing that we teach is, you know, God has given you a lot of different gifts and we just need to take advantage of those talents. And all I ask of our students every single day is to do their best.
Yeah.
And that's all we can ask for.
All of the past Faith and Friends shows and videos can be found on our website, faithandfriends.wtlw.com, and on the WTLW TV YouTube page. And of course, you can share those on your social media pages. We encourage you to share those as much as you possibly can. Well, earlier today, we talked about resolutions. Now it's time to talk about the 2017 Faith Challenge. Are you ready for a 12-month spiritual workout? No need to step on the treadmill, and we aren't even going to measure your body fat or put you on a stringent diet. Instead, we hope to offer you ideas that will enrich your life, bring you closer to Christ, and find ways to experience spiritual freedom and a stronger faith.
Now, this year, our topics will include ways to cut down on worry and increase trust, renewing of the mind, following God's lead, reconciliation and forgiveness, and more. But we start out our 2017 workout with two important disciplines, daily prayer and daily Bible reading. There's no right or wrong way to make a daily prayer and Bible reading plan. What is key is making a plan that will work for you and one that can become a habit.
Start by talking about a daily Bible reading plan. And if you're not reading the Bible every day, then the easy answer is to start. But where do you start? And that's always an important question. Andy, a few years ago, I remember you talking about you were committing to reading the Bible on a daily basis. How did you start and what's worked in your life?
I started at the beginning, first of all, Genesis. And I went through a simple chronological Bible plan where I would just read until, you know, I really was processing the information. Sometimes it was several pages because it was a story. You know, reading through Genesis, you hear a lot of those stories. And as you get later on, the New Testament, Acts is a great book. You don't want to put down because there's so many things happening. There's so many different stories. But stuff like Leviticus or perhaps the prophets, you know, you really have to take some time to read what's being said there. In fact, just a few days ago, I was reading in Isaiah, and I only got 5 words in because I was just hit by the gravity of what was saying there. And I couldn't go on because I just kept meditating and praying on those 5 words. So I would say it's great to try and read through the entire Bible in a year, but don't force yourself. I got to get through 3.7 pages to get through the Bible in a year. Really, just soak it in. It's a story. And as you read it chronologically, it's helped me to see that story aspect come out.
So you still are working on your one-year Bible plan. You're into the second year, aren't you?
Right, but I've read every day through the first year, and so going to continue that here. And I think once I get to the New Testament, it gets cooking because there's a lot of good stories there.
And, you know, there's a lot of different Bible plans out there, mm-hmm. and some are set up chronologically to start at Genesis and take you all the way through. There's many other plans that will have you read a couple of books or a couple of chapters from the New Testament, a couple of chapters from the Old Testament, and maybe a book from a psalm each day. And that's one way you can get through. And some Bibles are set up for daily reading plans. There are many online as well. BackToTheBible.org offers several daily Bible reading plans. Now, we've chosen one from a website that will follow through this year. Now, some won't follow as quickly as it recommends. Some want to study the Bible, not just read it. So for Andy, for example, it takes longer to get through, and that is certainly okay. And while there's other plans that are set up chronologically and gives you on January 3rd, you need to read this chapter and this chapter and this chapter, you know, there are other plans that are not set up based on a calendar. It's just week one, day one. So if you're thinking to yourself, well, it's January 31st, I haven't read January, I'm lost, I can't do this year. That's not the case. You can find a plan that will allow you to just start week one, day one, and you can pick it up at any point during the year and read through the Bible.
Daily Bible reading and daily prayer. Those are two things we encourage you to commit to, making these parts of your life. We'll talk more next week about daily prayer. And of course, both of those are part of our 2017 Faith Challenge 12 Spiritual Workouts. And we'll be right back after this.
Hey, this is Kyle Lance Martin with Revive Ohio. And I gotta tell you, God is doing something special in the Mercer County area. Well, what does that look like? It looks like students are going out praying and sharing the gospel on their days off or snow days, whatever you want to say. Local businesses are inviting us in to share the gospel with their employees. And we're even getting into the jail. The judge is inviting us into the courtroom to pray and share the gospel with people that are desperate and are ready and hungry for hope. God's doing something unique. For more information, go to reviveoh.com.
Well, hopefully you have heard the importance of scripture memorization. The Bible is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword, and it truly contains such nuggets of gold for us in our lives. Well, how about memorizing passage upon passage upon passage, maybe even 20 verses in a row or more? Well, today I'm going to introduce you to two young ladies who have achieved incredible things in regards to Bible memorization, Bible study, all kinds of incredible things when it comes to the Bible itself. They are both winners, fourth place winners in the National Bible Bee, and we're excited to have them on with us today. Ann Cox is the mom. Emily and Olivia Cox are the prize-winning daughters. We're so happy to have you joining us today. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Well, let's start by talking about the National Bible Bee, because that's why we have these two ladies with us this morning. Anne, tell me a little bit about the National Bible Bee, how your family got involved and what it is.
My children have been involved in Bible quizzing in the past, where they memorize and study a book and compete with other teams. And a few years ago, I read an article in World Magazine about the National Bible Bee, where children were studying scripture, learning hundreds of passages, and competing for prizes at a national level, similar to the National Spelling Bee. And I said to Emily, "Does that sound like that would be interesting to you?" And so the next year we signed up for it. It starts with a summer program where the kids study a book of the Bible in depth They study cross-references to keywords in that scripture and look for those words all over the Bible. They study Greek words, and they memorize 24 passages that they need to recite to someone outside the family at the end of the summer, and then they take an online test, and the test qualifies them. The top 120 children in each age division are invited to come to national competition.
And so this year, not for the first time, but this year your girls made it in that top 120.
Yes.
You've been doing this for several years. You've made several trips to nationals, but this year the results were higher than they ever have been, right?
Right.
Yes. Well, as we mentioned to you, both girls did finish fourth place in their respective divisions, and we'd like to talk with them a little bit today to talk about that. First, let's start with Emily. This is your fifth year in the Bible Bee. You've been to the Nationals several times. Explain to me, what do you like about the Bible Bee?
To prepare for it, you have to study the Bible really in depth, and that's really exciting. And I would never have learned to study the Bible as in depth as I know how if I hadn't done it. And you also have to memorize, and that makes you understand passages better than you would do when you're just reading them.
Mm. What makes studying and memorizing the scripture so worth it?
You just find more and more reasons to trust the Bible, and more reasons to believe in God and obey Him.
Would you like to quote for us from the passages that you learned this year?
1 John 4:9-21. In this the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent His only Son into the world so that we might live through Him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us and His love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in Him and He in us, because He has given us of His Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent His Son to be the Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him and he in God. So we have come to know and to believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. By this is love perfected with us, so that we may have confidence for the day of judgment, because as He is, so also are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not been perfected in love. We love because He first loved us. If anyone says, I love God and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. And this commandment we have from him: whoever loves God must also love his brother.
All right. Thank you very much, Emily. Fourth place finisher in the senior division at the National Bible Bee. Olivia, I saw you mouthing some of that scripture, so you know a lot of it too, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
What passages did you have to memorize this year? What book of the Bible?
The same book as Emily.
The very same one. All right. Would you like to quote some scripture for us today too?
Yeah.
What would you like to quote?
1 John 1:1-10.
All right. Go ahead.
That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. The life was made manifest, and we have seen it, and testified to it, and proclaimed to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and was made manifest to us. That which we have seen and heard, we proclaim also to you, so that you too may have fellowship with us. And indeed, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And we are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us.
Excellent. Excellent. Also fourth place finisher in the primary division at the National Bible Bee. Girls, that's incredible. Of course, it's wonderful to see you both do so well in the competition, but it's just wonderful to see how much scripture you have memorized, and I'm sure you're going to carry that with you for the rest of your life. Thank you both. Thank you all of you for joining us on Faith and Friends, and thank you, ladies, for what you've done. Congratulations. It's very impressed. We are very impressed with you. There will be another Bible Bee coming up next year. You'll have to watch and see if the Cox sisters are on the big screen again. It is live streamed. And of course, we actually carry the National Bible Bee game show here on TV 44. I'm not sure yet if we're going to have that again this year, but stay posted and we will let you know. Back to you.
Shifting from one set of influential sisters to another group of influential students, Auglaize County has been busy giving toys away. Minster senior Rosie Westerbeck just completed her Red Wagon campaign over Christmas, and the New Bremen Fellowship of Christian Athletes group teamed up with the Student Council to collect toys and deliver them to Dayton Children's Hospital. A special way to bring smiles to little faces. Here's today's OIO Faith on the Field segment.
I've been coordinating a toy drive along with the NHS at school here, and so we've got toys from people in the community and students here at New Bremen, and we're going to bring them down to Dayton Children's to let the kids have some toys after their treatments.
It was so meaningful. We gave all the toys to Dayton Children's, and my brother, when he was born, went there, so I know the effect that they have on all those kids and how it boosts their spirits.
I was in the hospital a few times and got infusions for a platelet disorder that I had, and that was like the highlight of my day, getting to pick out a prize from the box afterwards, and so I know they'll really enjoy it.
And God teaching knee camp a lot during the swimming season.
In sports, at least, just like my teammates and showing love to everybody, and just with this project that we're doing with FCA, just especially around the holidays, like thinking about others and not just yourself.
New Bremen has chaplains for both its football and girls basketball teams, and they've seen growth in their weekly huddle.
It's a lot bigger since we started doing it, not in the morning at school. We've gotten a ton of new freshmen, and it's been going well.
FCA has been my structure this year. When I'm feeling down and I just can't get through school, I know that I can always go to an FCA meeting and get my focus back.
Well, thank you very much for that story, Andy.
You're welcome.
Well, we are in the final weeks of our annual Pledge Drive campaign for this new year we're now in, and we are pleased to announce we have raised $185,000 in donations and gifts.
You.
We're so thankful to the many of you who are continuing to pledge as our campaign runs through the end of January. I'd love to see us go over the 200,000 mark. That would just be a great blessing for us.
And where does your money go when you support TV 44? Well, it impacts people like Mary, who say things like this. I'm unable to attend church on Sunday mornings, and TV 44 is my church. Thank you for being there.
It's so comforting to know this station's always there. Any time of the day or night, regardless of what's going on in my life, I can turn on TV 44 and have a friend. Thank you, Phyllis. Tom says, I grew up in church but walked away from my faith as an adult. Then one day I found TV 44, and when the preacher on TV asked who was ready to turn back to God, I knew I had to do it. It's the best decision ever. Thank you, TV 44.
this summer, TV 44 celebrates 35 years on the air. And there are many of you who have supported us from the beginning. Thank you so much. Together, we are reaching people like Mary, Phyllis, Tom, and so many more.
And again, we just want to encourage you to continue with your spiritual workout for 2017, focusing on daily prayer and daily Bible reading.